This episode is sponsored by Tide. Only use Tide Pods for laundry. Only for laundry. Vsauce, I'm Jake, and if you ever stared at your washing machine while it's cleaning clothes and wondered, what is happening in there?
I have, and I have a lot of questions because what's going on behind me is a multitude of chemical reactions all happening on a level that is generally unobservable by the human eye. So how does a laundry detergent like Tide Pods clean the numerous amounts of different stains from clothes? And once it removes a stain from a piece of clothing, why doesn't that stain then go into the water and get on all of the clothing in the wash? Where does the stain go?
Well, let's start with water. Water on its own isn't very good at cleaning things. Water has very strong cohesion, surface tension. It likes to stick with water. You can see this when you pour water on glass. Drops form on its surface, or when poured on the ground, it all pools together. It also won't bind with fats or oils. Try washing a greasy pan with just water. It washes right off, carrying very little, if any, of the grease with it. That's where detergent comes in. It uses a couple of key ingredients: surfactants, anti-redeposition polymers, builders, and enzymes. And enzymes act a lot like the ones that can be found in carnivorous plants like Venus flytraps or pitcher plants, or even the enzymes in our own body. The main difference is that these are manufactured in giant microbe vats. Enzymes are molecules that are biological catalysts. They help certain chemical reactions break down molecules into smaller amino acids. Now, different enzymes break down different things, and there are a bunch of varieties within this little pod, but two I want to focus on in particular are protease and amylase. Now, protease break down proteins, which are the key components in grass and bloodstains. To see it at work, we need something that is, well, primarily protein, like Jell-O. Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Our Jell-O with water doesn't do very much, but our Jell-O with protease does. After only a few hours, it completely dissolves the entire thing. Then we get to amylase, which is an enzyme that is particularly good at dealing with starchy stains like gravy, oatmeal, or baby food. And side note, amylase is also used in the process of brewing beer. It converts the starches into sugars in fermentation. Okay, let's see it break down something starchy like cereal. Again, our container with water doesn't do much, whereas the container with amylase turns the cereal into goo. In addition to protease and amylase, there is also mannanase to break down thickeners in foods like ice cream. And while that's all well and good, we still have a problem. Water. That's where surfactants and anti-redeposition polymers come in. Surfactants is short for surface active agents, and they basically make water wet better. What I mean by that is surfactants reduce the cohesion, the water molecules sticking to each other, and surface tension, allowing it to spread across, around, and into the fibers of whatever is being cleaned instead of just sticking together with the other water molecules. And what is really cool about surfactants is that they have a very unusual chemical structure. The surfactant molecules have a small head and a long tail. The tail is hydrophobic. It attracts the fat, grease, and dirt molecules, while the head is hydrophilic, and it attracts water molecules. The tails stick into the dirt surrounding it, creating a micelle. This isolates the stains from other molecules, and then the head is attached to the water, suspending those stain particles in that water, keeping all that grime and gunk from reattaching to the fabric. And then we have anti-redeposition polymers. They're special polymers that work with surfactants to capture and suspend soil in the water, basically trapping it. So that answers our questions about why stains don't go from one piece of clothing to all pieces of clothing. But we're not done with water just yet, because tap water is full of things like calcium and metals that interfere with the washing process. So detergents use builders, water conditioners, to attract them and keep them out of the way, similar to the way that surfactants capture dirt and grime. And once your clothes have been cleaned by enzymes and builders and surfactants, there is one more chemical process. Let's turn the lights off. If we shine a flashlight on a Tide Pod, it looks normal. But if we switch our flashlight to UV, this happens. It's optical brighteners. They absorb UV light and re-emit it into the visible spectrum, making your clothing brighter. When that UV light is re-emitted, it does so in the blue visible spectrum, making things appear whiter by changing the color temperature of light. And optical brighteners aren't just found in detergent, they're used in things like papers, cosmetics, and in plastics, like that nice white charger that you use for your devices. Also, check out my teeth. My toothpaste has optical brighteners. And if I had to venture a guess, some of the clothing you're wearing right now was made with brighteners in it. So all detergent does is replenish what gets washed away when you clean your fabrics. This is why if you've ever been in a place with a bunch of UV or black lights, you've probably noticed how white shirts glow. It surprised me how much is actually happening in your washing machine, because from the surface, it looks so straightforward. And it wasn't until years ago when I read Mary Roach's incredible book that I realized what a clever and complicated bit of science is happening in there. And in it, Mary interviews a P&G researcher, the folks who make Tide, which was what led me to talking to the researchers there as well. So thank you to Tide for finding this topic interesting, and for supporting this video, and for supporting Vsauce. And, as always, thanks for watching.